My name is Peter Davies. I'm the Commissioner for Sustainable Futures, and it's a great pleasure to be able to welcome you all here today. This conversation is on behalf of future generations. It's an opportunity for us to look beyond the short-term pressures of everyday life and the short-term pressures of decision-making within governments, to look at what we want for our children and our grandchildren. It'll help us to focus on the long-term legacy that we want to leave for future generations, and recognise that the future doesn't just happen, but we create it through the decisions that we make today. It's important that this conversation is seen in the context of the Future Generations Bill, and we'll be hearing more from the Minister in a moment about the nature of that bill and how this conversation will be critical to its success. We want to invite you to participate in the conversation from the start. So there's a Twitter wall in the best traditions of today. There are also in the best traditions of yesterday postcards, which you can fill in and leave with us. We are being live streamed, so if you want to catch up or if you want to pass on to other people who are not here, it'll be recorded. This is a conversation, it's not a consultation. So, we have an exciting time ahead of us in terms of the speakers that we've got lined up, a little bit of stardust, as you know, as well. But most importantly, I'm joined in hosting this launch today by Kerris Davies, a better representative of future generations, I think, than myself. She's from Wrexham, she's a student in Aberystwyth, and most importantly, she's a council member of Funky Dragon, the Youth Assembly for Wales. So let's give Kerris a big welcome.
So pawb sydd yma heddiw, enw fi yw Cerys, fel dywedodd Peter o'r blaen, ac dwi dod o Draig Funky. Dwi'n aelod o'r grŵp iaith Cymraeg a Draig Funky, a dwi'n meddwl mae hynny'n pwysig. Ac mae'r digwyddiad heddiw yn ffantastig fod cymaint o pobl yma. Ac eto, gai jyst ail ddweud i'r ffaith i pawb rhoi tweets os da chi gallu afael hashtag the Wales we want. Os mae pawb yn gallu gwneud yr unrhyw adeg a mae'r trafodaeth yn mynd yn pellach na heddiw, so os da chi eisiau gwneud hynny ar ôl heddiw ac yn y dyfodol a amog i ffrindiau a cydweithwyr wneud yr un peth hefyd, fath o honna'n ardderchog i ni wneud. Edel i am gweld fideo fyr nawr o pobl ar ddos Cymru yn sôn am y Cymru maen nhw eisiau a beth maen nhw'n annog ar gyfer y dyfodol o heddiw. Diolch.
The importance, though, of those views is about how we shape the long-term vision and goals for Wales, which will be built into the Future Generations Bill. So it gives me great pleasure to introduce the Minister, Jeff Cuthbert, the Minister for Communities and Tackling Poverty, who's the Minister responsible for leading the Bill. Minister.
Diolch, Carys a Peter. Pnawn da, mae'n bleser bod yma heddiw. Good afternoon. I'm delighted to be with you here today at the launch of the National Conversation on the Wales We Want. This is an important milestone in our efforts to improve the lives of people across Wales, ensuring that we leave a better legacy for our children's children. Last year, I asked Peter Davies, the Commissioner for Sustainable Futures, to pilot a national conversation on the Wales we want. And I'm very pleased to be here at the launch and to share the platform with such inspirational speakers. To see so many people here today and a rich and wide-ranging series of events planned to run across Wales is very exciting. As most of you will know, the Welsh Government is planning to introduce what we're calling the Future Generations Bill. This is the working title for our legislation to put sustainable development at the heart of our public service. The bill is about providing a shared vision of the Wales that we want, with our generation taking responsibility for improving the well-being of Wales and providing a sustainable Wales for decades to come. We want to stimulate our businesses, our public service, the third sector, and government to work together to achieve a shared vision. Our refreshed Sustainable Development Charter can be a useful driver for positive change. The bill will set ambitious, long-term goals to reflect the Wales that we want to see. This is a distinct Welsh approach. We intend to do this by putting a set of key goals into law. Thinking about goals isn't unique to Wales. It has been aligned to a similar process taking place at the international level through the United Nations to replace the Millennium Development Goals. It's clear to me that smaller devolved nations like Wales can show a lead and set an example about how to put in practice the conditions for the well-being of a sustainable Wales now and in the future. Last month, I spoke to UNICEF regarding our proposals for Wales and was encouraged by the positive response that we received. In Wales, we have the opportunity to lead on this, building on our long history of sustainable development and the examples we see in business, which is so often leading the way. The Welsh Government's proposed draft goals for Wales have each been shaped to reflect the long-term economic, social, and environmental well-being of Wales and, more importantly, to work together as an integrated set of goals. I want to feed these into the discussions that will take place during this national conversation. The proposed draft goals that set out the Wales we want in 2050 are: Wales is prosperous and innovative. Wales uses a fair share of natural resources. Wales is a more equal nation. Communities across Wales are safe, cohesive, and resilient. People in Wales participate in our shared culture with a thriving, living Welsh language. People in Wales are healthier. And I think in terms of the video clip that we just saw, those goals chime with that. Now, these are only proposed draft goals. They may be modified, not least as a result of the national conversation. There will be more meat on the bone as we move towards the introduction of the bill. These are our place markers to help the conversation across Wales. This is the Wales I and the Welsh Government want to see over the long term. It is our expression of what the well-being of a sustainable Wales should look like. But I recognise that different approaches and emphasis could help with what's being developed. This is where we need your help. The approach we're taking in seeking your views is a little different, as Peter has mentioned, in that it isn't a formal consultation and that it's led by an independent commissioner. But it's important for us to understand the views of people and communities across Wales on their priorities, challenges, and needs for the future. I want the views of rural and urban communities, children, young people, older people, and those in the middle, businesses, voluntary groups, and the public organizations who serve us all. Getting young people involved in these conversations is important to me, as we need to know about the Wales that they want to inherit. In this regard, I'm particularly grateful to the children and young people from Danescourt Primary School, Fitzalan High School, Millbank Primary School, and Ysgol Gyfan Cymraeg Plas Mawr for coming along to the poetry workshops this morning. I wait with bated breath to hear the poems for the Wales we want from Urig and Rufus. I'm reminded of the words of Gwyneth Lewis that stand out so clearly on the face of this building, in these stones, horizons sing. I think that they are an apt expression of what we're working towards. I'm told that Gwynedd wrote those words to reflect the cultural ambition of the Wales Millennium Centre, thus recognising where we've come from and where we want to be. This is what I hope we'll get from the national conversation, an understanding of what's important to us as a nation and the pathway that we want to follow. Now, looking far ahead can be challenging and difficult. The challenges and priorities that we face at the moment may change in the future. We're supporting this pilot national conversation to help us try and find what works and what doesn't. The national conversation is an exercise that we hope will be repeated in the future by the new Commissioner for Future Generations. We propose to ensure that engagement with people across Wales is secured in law so that it does not become a one-off conversation. This is just the beginning of a journey that will affect every person as well as communities and business in Wales. Doing it well, and that may be hard and challenging at times, will depend on everybody, government, business, the third sector, people and communities across Wales working better together to achieve the Wales that we want. So to conclude, I look very much to hearing the results of these conversations in the weeks ahead. Diolch yn fawr. Thank you very much.
Ac eisiau diolch i'r gweinidog am yr araith hynny, ac diolch i pawb am gwrando. Nawr mae ganddyn ni Sir sydd dod ymlaen i'r stad heddiw. Michael Sheen sydd dod i fyny dechreuodd, sydd dod i fyny heddiw, ac enillodd Michael y Gwobr, Theatr y Ddeinas Unedig, am gyfarwyddo yn ystod a chael ei enwebu a gyda'r Gwobr Actor Gorau gan Bafftr Cymru ar ôl ei rôl yn y ffilm The Gospel of the The Gospel of Us. Y 2009 cafodd Michael Sheen ei anrhyddeddu gyda OBE gan y Frenhines am ei wasanaeth i'r ddrama. Dechreuodd Michael gefnogi UNICEF y 2010 pam cymerodd thrân yn Soccer Aid. Y flwyddyn honno, yn Hachwedd 2013, trafeiliodd Michael i Libant i gyfarfod y rhai o'r pods sydd wedi eu trafeilio yna i cael eu gwahodd o Syria. Rydym wrth i bod fod Michael yma heddiw i ymuno â'r trafodaeth ac i hysbysebu beth sy'n digwydd heddiw. Felly, gael croeso i'r llwyfan heddiw, Michael Sheen.
Diolch yn fawr, Shemai. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, Minister, I am hugely honoured to have been given this opportunity to speak before you today. This day that marks a call for the people of Wales to begin a national conversation. Any opportunity to have your voice heard is of immense importance and brings with it an innate responsibility. Encouraging people to speak about their experience, their struggles, and their hopes for the future should be at the center of any culture. Only then can we face the truth about ourselves and move forward in a healthy and positive way. It takes honesty and courage. It's not easy, but the benefits can be immense, creating a culture based on inclusivity and respect, of dignity and participation, where every voice feels heard and each life feels important, benefits everyone. I hope that this opportunity for us as a nation to speak our truth, to describe our experiences, to be clear about what is important to us, and to lay out our hopes for where we want to be heading, to tell our story. I hope that it will be taken up with enthusiasm and with positivity, even whilst what is being spoken may at times describe some harsh truths and difficult realities. We're all aware that this is an immensely challenging time in the history of our country. Financial restrictions are taking a heavy toll on everyone. Support services and access to all kinds of cultural opportunities are being eroded. I have witnessed the path that has led to me standing here this very day, being swept away behind me, making it virtually impossible for anyone to follow in my footsteps. There is no drama department in my school anymore. The Westcliff Morgan Youth Theatre, possibly one of the best youth theatre groups in the entire world, has had its funding cut and its existence put into grave danger. And the access that young people had to what, when I was growing up, was a flourishing and enthusiastically supported youth arts culture in the county has been severely restricted. The results of that earlier support have borne extraordinary fruit. Over recent years, we have seen television production here in Wales that has led the world in its quality and its cultural impact. The work of my fellow youth theatre member, Russell T. Davies, has quite literally revolutionised the world of televisual entertainment in this country, and with productions like Doctor Who, led to enormous creative productivity here in Wales. A few years ago, I was given the opportunity to create what was described as the theatrical event of the decade, possibly of any decade, when alongside the people of my hometown, we performed The Passion of Portalbert for National Theatre Wales. An extraordinary coming together of youth arts groups, charitable support services, voluntary organizations, and community cultural projects that transformed a town and all of us in it into the proudest people on earth for a time as the world listened to our story. Another youth theatre member, Edward Thomas, has been instrumental in bringing about the establishment of a major production studio close to my hometown on the border of Swansea, which promises much for the future and is already, alongside the major productions going on there, having a profound impact on the surrounding community, especially its young people. This enormous cultural wealth and the financial boon that it brings along with it is a direct result of the opportunity, the support, and the access that we had to a healthy cultural and artistic environment as we were growing up. I passionately hope that the Future Generations Bill takes that into account, that it allows for creative opportunities, for the nurturing of the abundance of Welsh talent that exists, and ensuring Wales provides a space to sustain these homegrown talents with regards to education and the infrastructure to develop skills. That voice must be found, it must be nurtured, and it must be given support. But speaking your truth and having a voice is only half the story. That voice and those truths must be heard. They have to be listened to and taken seriously with a spirit of openness and receptivity, no matter how challenging what is being spoken may be. If there is truly a desire with this national conversation to understand the long-term issues that future generations might face, a real attempt at engagement with the people of Wales in understanding what are the most important issues for them in improving their lives and the lives of the families and communities that they are at the heart of, their children and their children's children, then there must be at the heart of this enterprise the transparency and the honesty to be truly accountable and the courage to go beyond the short-term thinking that can lead to making decisions more based on the pressures and demands of day-to-day political life and the exigencies of a political career, rather than the very real requirements of a people whose day-to-day lives and families' futures should always take precedence. In 2011, outlining the Welsh Government's legislative programme for the next 5 years, the First Minister said that sustainability lies at the heart of the Welsh Government's agenda for Wales. And indeed, the Welsh Government's commitment to sustainable development in how it is attempting to move forward is very encouraging. The whole concept of sustainable development, though, has one very obvious logical starting point, and that is our children. They will inhabit and be the source of our future generations. They will implement and experience the consequences of the Future Generations Bill. It is they who will live tomorrow in the reality of whatever we create for them today. The choices we make now will dictate the context that they will experience their struggles in. The decisions we make in this moment will either help or hinder their progress in their future that is to come. I stand here today as an advocate for UNICEF. UNICEF is guided by possibly the most important document ever created for the well-being of children, the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child. The convention spells out the basic human rights that children everywhere have to thrive and survive, and two really important principles at the heart of this convention are acting in the best interest of children and giving children a voice on issues that affect them. It gives me great pride to be able to say that Wales is the leader in the UK when it comes to child rights and implementation on the Convention on the Rights of the Child. The Welsh Assembly Government adopted the Convention in 2004 as a basis for all its policy, making a commitment to work to promote and support the rights of children in Wales. In 2011, a groundbreaking legislation was adopted, imposing a legal duty on Welsh ministers to have due regard to the rights and obligations in the Convention. The fact that the Welsh Government is showing such an inspiring commitment to child rights-based thinking is all the more important given the challenges that face children and young people in Wales today. Recent government figures put child poverty levels at 31% of children in Wales. Based on these figures, to meet the Welsh Government's laudable 2020 target to eradicate child poverty altogether, current levels would have to fall four times as fast in the next decade as they did in the last. What's more, as a result of the austerity programme instigated by the UK government in 2010, it is broadly recognised that the children of low-income families will be hit hardest, and that a direct impact of the reforms will be to increase child poverty, with latest forecasts showing 1 million more children living in poverty throughout the UK by 2020. As someone who has spent their life in the business of storytelling, I have learned that the beginning of a story is a precarious and vitally important stage. The rest of the story and how the audience will experience it is dictated by what happens in those first moments. We're surrounded by stories constantly, a vast array of them, and we need some way of being able to understand how to relate to the particular story in front of us. What are the rules? What's our role in the process? An audience is in no way a passive entity in the story. It actively participates in the experience of the story being told and in the manner of its telling. An audience is never more receptive than at the beginning, sponge-like, hungry for information, desperate to orientate itself among all the possibilities that stories can contain, and eager to learn the rules that the storytellers can impart about how to get the most out of the story they are about to tell. Now, it doesn't matter what the performers might say about what the rules are. The audience learns from what they actually experience, the manner of the interaction between performer and audience, not what they are told. Many an actor has begun a story desperately wanting the audience to like them, trying to get laughs where they can, regardless of whether the story requires it or not. And then, later on, been incensed by the audience laughing at moments that they want taken seriously, little realizing that the audience is only responding in the way they were taught to in the early stages of the performance. They've been told the wrong rules, not by the script necessarily, but by the way they have been related to by the performers, by the quality of their relationship early on. The audience hasn't changed. They show perfect consistency to the way they have been related to. And children are the same. No matter what they are told about how to behave, what values they should have, what goals they should aspire to, what they actually learn from is the manner in which they are treated, how they are related to, the unspoken rules that create the reality they grow up in. If those rules are based on equality, dignity, respect, non-discrimination, and participation, not just by saying that those qualities are important, but by actually displaying those qualities in all interactions with children and young people. If those qualities are inherent in our institutions, in the way our public services function and are planned, in the very fabric of our society, then those children will truly value those qualities and principles, and they will reflect them back to their communities as they grow into adulthood. Finding a balance between the guidance and nurturing that totally dependent beings require and, on the other hand, the independence and freedom to express their views and have them be listened to with respect and openness is a difficult challenge. This is not about creating future generations with a raging sense of entitlement and egotistical selfishness, but attempting to engender a sense of inclusivity and responsibility, to feel part of the process of making decisions on issues that affect them now or will affect them in the future can have a hugely beneficial effect on a child's sense of belonging to and therefore responsibility toward their community. This early inclusivity has a huge part to play in tackling the apathy or alienation that can all too easily become prevalent later, often as a result of feeling unheard and marginalized at a younger age. They are only reflecting back what they have learned from experience rather than what they have been told. Of course, not every child is fortunate enough to be born into a family or the circumstances in which these qualities and principles are present. And this is why focusing on support services within communities is so important. When primary caregivers cannot meet children's needs for whatever reason, it is up to society to fill the gap or pay the consequences later. In November of 2013, UNICEF UK launched a bold new initiative. The Child Rights Partners Programme brings together UNICEF UK and local government. It aims to put children's rights at the heart of public services in the UK. Over 3 years, UNICEF UK will work with 6 local authorities, including my hometown of Neath and Portalbert. Neath Portalbert has a population that includes 25,164 children. It has the third highest density of deprived communities in Wales, and a child poverty rate of 24%. 1 in 4 children living in poverty. 1 in 4 children living in poverty. Having visited some of the women's shelters, witnessed firsthand sessions with those living with addiction, talked with carers, both adult and at times shockingly young carers, as young as 12, sometimes even younger. Having talked with young people coming out of the care system and struggling to survive suddenly alone, suffering discriminatory violence and at times being hounded out of precious accommodation, I know some of the challenges that that most extraordinary community faces on a day-to-day basis. And the incredibly difficult circumstances that the people working to provide services set up to tackle these issues are dealing with, some of which are here today. Severe underfunding being just one. Too often, vulnerable children are in danger of falling through the gaps in the provision of essential services, and generational cycles of exposure and abuse go unbroken. As well as partnering with the council itself to look at the way they fund, organise and commission services for children, UNICEF will also be working with Portalbert and Avon Women's Aid, the Welsh Centre for Action on Dependency and Addiction, and the mental health organisation Gofal Cymru. Together, they will attempt to pilot and model child rights-based approaches to working with troubled families. This is a bold and courageous investment in the future by Neath Portalbert, and could provide an inspiring model for the rest of the country to learn from. Incorporating the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child into domestic law is a necessary step in enabling all children, regardless of their background or circumstances, to realize all of their rights. There is no such thing as a small right. There is no hierarchy of human rights. These rights are indivisible and interrelated with a focus on the child as a whole. The UNICEF UK Rights Respecting School Award initiative began in 2004 and has more than 1,600 primary and secondary schools in total registered for the scheme. 133 Welsh schools have been celebrated for their positive approach to children's rights. I'm visiting one, Havard Primary School in Swansea, tomorrow morning, in fact. A 2010 study has indicated that by schools adopting this child rights-based approach, children attend more frequently, bullying levels have been reduced, academic standards have improved, and there's a greater respect for the rights of religions, cultures, beliefs, and abilities different to their own. To see the concrete results that this approach can achieve only makes me even more certain that adopting the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child into the Future Generations Bill could have a profound effect on the children of Wales and the future they will inhabit, and would send a clear signal to the rest of the world about the commitment that this country has to sustainable development and the generations to come. At a time when the reductions in the Welsh Government's budget are expected to amount to £1.8 billion, or 7% over 4 years, it is inspiring to see them focus so much on long-term thinking, sustainable solutions, and progressive approaches to children's rights in Wales. Wales is leading the way on a global level when it comes to the sustainable development cause, and it is just this kind of bold and courageous response to the financial limitations that are being imposed that will make possible the kind of future that we would hope to provide for the generations to come. The Convention on the Rights of the Child sets out the necessary environment and means to enable every human being to develop to their full potential. Imagine what this could mean to future generations, to our society as a whole. Children growing up with a better chance of becoming responsible, creative, and valued members of their communities, respectful toward themselves and others, in spite of whatever constraints they may experience at home, finding support and encouragement in the very services that their society provides them with. Access to opportunities to express themselves, to have a voice, to participate, confident in the knowledge that they will be heard and their opinion respected. And if not, knowing it is their inalienable right and having the means to bring it about. This is the Wales I want. This is our responsibility to future generations. They are not some abstract concept, those generations of the future, floating around in silver spacesuits or something, inevitable, but disconnected from us through the mists of time. The relationship between us and them is absolutely concrete. We are engaging in a dialogue with them every day of our lives, every moment of every day, by the choices we make now, by whether we make decisions that are about short-term values and self-centered principles, or whether they are based on a desire to grow and nurture and be a part of something bigger than ourselves, to all move forward together with compassion and respect, showing our strength as a community by taking care of those of us who are most vulnerable, and showing our face to the world as a society that can truly celebrate its values, that with a voice rich with integrity and thrilling in its courage and its boldness, can stand before all the peoples of the world and proudly tell our story. Thank you.
What can I say, Michael? Thank you so much for beginning our story, beginning this conversation with such passion, with such power, with such integrity, setting out the importance of speaking the truth, of being courageous, of being transparent through this conversation, the importance of young people, putting that at the centre of the conversation. And I'm delighted that we'll be working with the Children's Commissioner, Keith, who's with us today, in taking this conversation forward through the young people of Wales. And also the importance of place and the passion that you have for your place. And I think that's a really important part of the conversation. Wales as a whole, but our individual places that we call home, and where we have that sense of identity, belonging and ownership, which Michael obviously has. Michael, thank you so much for being with us today, for being an ambassador for UNICEF, for being an ambassador for Keep Wales Tidy in Wales, being an ambassador for Portalbert. I must be the only person, because I had an auntie in Portalbert, who went from Pembrokeshire to Portalbert for summer holidays. But most of all, thank you for being an ambassador for Wales. Now, I normally would struggle thinking, have we got somebody to follow that? Now, I know we have somebody to follow that because I'm now about to introduce Sir Jonathon Porritt. Jonathon is a friend. Jonathon is a mentor and a guide. Jonathon has lit the flame of a commitment to sustainable development in many people and in many countries, certainly me included and Wales included. He's carried that flame in so many ways as chair of the Sustainable Development Commission, as founder of Forum for the Future. And now, in the context of the day, as an author, in respect of the world we made, looking back from 2050, to tell the story of how we got to 2050 and to make sure that 2050 is a much better place than we have today. So a big welcome to Sir Jonathon Porritt.
Peter, thank you very much indeed. And I am delighted to be back in Wales. I'm always delighted to be back in Wales, not least because of the opportunity to listen to incredibly eloquent and moving speakers. And thank you, Michael. That was a wonderful talk. Wonderful talk. I'm here to reassure you that by 2050, we will have created this amazing, fair, compassionate, sustainable world that every single person here, and I suspect when given half a chance, every single person across the length and breadth of this country hopes will be what our future looks like. Because it may surprise you to know that there aren't actually that many people who get out of bed every morning with the explicit intention of trashing the prospects of life on Earth so that all future generations have an utterly miserable time of it. Not that many people. I've met a few in my life. I'm sure you've met some too along the way. Difficult to avoid sometimes, but by and large, we all still feel that sense of obligation, whether it's captured in formal legal conventions through the UN or captured in our own heartfelt sense of obligation to our own children, grandchildren, our communities, and so on. We all have that sense that we need to do a good job, not just for ourselves today, but for all future generations. And that, of course, is the heart of sustainable development. I have been doing sustainable development for a very long time, 40 years, in fact, and 4 years ago, I suddenly came to the conclusion that I hadn't really checked in on whether or not a genuinely fair, sustainable future was still available to us. I imagine some of you have the depressing experience of reading quite a lot in the media about how it is already too late to deliver this good world for people by 2050. That these converging crises, accelerating climate change, biodiversity extinctions, resource shortages, collapsing ecosystem services, the whole litany of the terrible consequences of our abuse of the natural world, I'm surrounded by people who tell me that that is so awful, an accumulated consequence that we're not going to be able to do this sustainable world by 2050. I call them the too late brigade. They're quite depressing. Because every time you hear them, and they are often fearsomely eloquent as well, you sort of think, okay, you may be right. I'm not quite sure what that does for me as an advocate for change, as a social entrepreneur, as a parent, as whatever it might be. How do you get up from that and go out and make this better world possible? I felt as a consequence of that, I ought to go and spend some time researching what it is that is going to make this world available to us. And I spent 2 years looking into every single field of human endeavor that will produce the combination of new technology and new systems, economic, political, social, ethical systems, to make this dream possible. Now, for me, that sounds probably to many of you a bit obvious, but actually, I've never been a terribly enthusiastic exponent of technology. I find technology, if I'm being absolutely honest, just a bit boring most of the time. I don't enthuse about cars. I honestly find IT largely unworkable. My life sort of continues despite all those problems I have with technology. So it's never been a big part of my life. Imagine the revelation when you suddenly dive into this world of utterly brilliant innovators all over the world who spend every single minute of their waking lives seeking to bring forward technological solutions to the problems we face today. It is impossible to give you a full account of just how vast and superabundant that innovation world looks like. Every single area that you want to think about from a sustainability perspective is populated by utterly brilliant people and utterly brilliant organizations trying to make those solutions happen. And yet most of our debate about sustainability is still cast in this incredibly narrow sense of what is or isn't possible. You think about how people talk about energy for the future. Just try stepping outside the tram lines that we've got used to of an energy world based entirely on fossil fuels and nuclear power, with a little bit of renewables added on for whatever purposes it may be. Most people cannot think outside of those tram lines. If you really open up to the power of innovation in renewable energy, in energy efficiency, in storage, in new smart grids, this world could be swept away really quite quickly. So in 2050, in the world we made, because we did make it, it's a success story. It is a story, Michael. You're right, we have to tell this through the medium of stories, because that's what makes people really respond to this opportunity. In 2050, we made that world. And right at the heart of that world is this energy revolution. As we exit the world of fossil fuels that is causing us such a problem today, and move through to a world of solar energy, essentially renewable power. 90% of the energy we use in 2050, with 9 billion people on this planet, remember, 2 billion more than we have today, making everything just a little bit harder, let's be honest. 9 billion people, 90% of the energy we use in 2050 comes from renewable energy sources. We've ceased to use coal almost entirely, apart from in India, which is still hanging on to a couple of old coal-fired clunkers. We've pretty much eliminated nuclear because we woke up to the fact that's not a brilliant option either. We stopped using oil in almost all purposes. Gas is still around a bit, but on a declining trajectory. 30% of the electricity we use comes from solar power alone. Now, you may say, Jonathon's just been spending too much time staring into these projections about what energy sources can bring us for the future. That wasn't what excited me. I spent a huge amount of time talking to people who work for organizations like the Fraunhofer Solar Institute. These are quite downbeat German engineers, largely. They don't do this kind of big shtick that I'm doing with you today. They talk very modestly about what's going to happen with their cherished breakthrough technologies on photovoltaics, on concentrated solar power, on thin film, whatever it might be. And when you really look at that innovation pipeline for the next 10 to 15 years, it is utterly astonishing. Utterly astonishing. But most of our politicians and most of our godforsaken media are still stuck in a prison. Their mindset will not allow them to see what this world really looks like. So on that score, honestly, kids, ladies and gentlemen, celebrate. The combined power of human genius with enough grit and determination from society to make it happen will provide the technology base for a sustainable world for 9 billion people by 2050. Now, I've been saying that throughout my life, but I never really bothered to find out whether it was true. I know it to be true now. I've seen what this looks like. But I can't quite end there. It's not just about technology. That technology will only serve the needs of humankind in the way that we need it to if our governance systems and our commitment to justice, to equity, to democracy, empower and inform that technology rollout. I think that was so important when we heard from the Minister, to keep reminding people that sustainable development is driven by two imperatives, not just the imperative of biophysical sustainability, living in an acceptable way with the constraints and the limits of nature, but it's driven by social justice as well. And there are many technology enthusiasts who don't want to talk to you about social justice. The power of sustainable development is it combines both of those two things together. That's why Wales is so important. It would be impossible for Wales to do sustainable development based purely on a concern about the physical environment if it wasn't utterly driven by this commitment to a fairer world. It wouldn't be true to the culture, the traditions, and the history of Wales. When I was chair of the Sustainable Development Commission, that was always a crucial part of the work we felt we were able to do here in Wales. It was always part of the leadership that Wales showed at that time, and it's part of the leadership that Wales shows today. Because, as you will all know, sustainable development has been pretty much rooted out of any aspect of political life in Whitehall. I know not why, but that combination of neoliberal conservatives and slightly misguided Lib Dems decided that sustainable development somehow wasn't part of their brave new world. God help them. Now I suspect, post the floods, we've suddenly heard a few people waking up to the realities of what this all looks like. Here in Wales, that commitment never went away. Peter Davies, as far as I know, is the sole remaining human presence representing the Sustainable Development Commission. What a survivor. So far as I know, this bill that is coming forward now, the Future Generations Bill, is not only unique in the UK. Can you imagine the Prime Minister, George Osborne, or anybody else standing up and saying, we think it's a critical time now to commit a key part of our legislative programme to a Future Generations Bill? Can you imagine that? It's unthinkable. So not only is it unique in the UK, but so far as I know, Minister, this is something that is pretty special anywhere in the world today, to commit to a statutory process to reflect those rights and interests, as Michael put it, of the next generation. Inspiring. The fact that it's doable, that such a future is still available to us, should make us all work that much harder to ensure that it does happen. So great to be here today. Start of a conversation where we start to tell our stories. Only just two things to end with. It doesn't happen by chance, this sustainable future. It happens because people dig in with unbelievable determination, courage, persistence, creativity, imagination to make it happen. That's what works. And much of that leadership comes from the usual suspects, if you like, from civil society organizations, from organizations that you don't hear so much about on sustainable development issues, including the business community, who are often taking a lead in this world today, and spiritual and religious communities. But most importantly, the leadership starts to come from young people themselves. Do not forget, this isn't just a conversation we dump on young people. This is a conversation that is more about their future than it is about our future. And in 2018, I know this for a fact, obviously, in 2018, young people all around the world basically rise up, apart from in Wales where they've sorted it out anyway, rise up and say, that's it, you lot. You've missed your chance. You failed to take advantage of the brilliant scientific knowledge we had. You failed to take advantage of the brilliant technologies we had available to us. You failed to do right by us as the next generation. You did not live up to your increasingly vacuous promises to create a more sustainable world for us as well as yourselves. You did none of that stuff. You got jolly good at talking about it, but you were frankly utterly rubbish at delivering it. And in 2018, all around the world, we have this mass uprising of young people that basically say, move aside. Not very far away, really, just a few years. My hope is that the things going on in Wales here today will actually avoid the need for revolution and make it happen, because we all share this sense of common purpose to deliver that better world anyway. Thank you.
Big thanks to Eirig and to Rufus for managing, and that was just this morning's workshop session reported back to you. Brilliant, brilliant innovation and creativity. And that's what the future's going to be reliant on, innovation and creativity. And that's why we're going to end the sort of formal session in terms of the final speaker, which is all about innovation, creativity, and enterprise. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Kelly Davis of Viability, who is a former Arsenal and Liverpool ladies footballer with 36 caps for Wales and is now making a huge difference through her enterprise and creativity. Kelly.
Good afternoon. My name's Kelly Davis and I'm the founder and managing director of a national award-winning social enterprise called Viability Educational Programme. I'd firstly like to take this opportunity to thank you for the opportunity to tell my story, especially with what's gone before. As a former Arsenal, Liverpool and Welsh international football player, my vision is for every community to have a thriving and financially stable sports club at its heart, providing opportunities for people to develop their skills, and by that I don't mean just their sports skills, I mean their life skills, their employability skills, to ultimately broaden their horizons. I came up with the idea of Viability when studying for an MBA in football industries, of which I was the youngest in Europe by about 15 years. And it was during this time I came up with the idea and I saw two big problems existed. One was there was a huge amount of young people not in education, not in employment, not in training, with no goals. And they needed a learning program that basically offered them more support and guidance, tapped into their interests and took place in a more inspirational environment. And the second problem was there was a huge amount of sports clubs or football clubs going into administration and not being run properly. And there was a need for a more professional approach to be adopted to generate income, to make it more sustainable, to bring them closer to community and basically take a bit of lead on being able to tackle a few different issues that are out there in the community. The solution I came up with was, with the help of a team of specialists, we developed a 10-week work-based training programme that would introduce young people to the commercialisation or the commercial management of sports clubs. So not only would it help them generate income, but would also basically bring them closer to the community and tackle social issues. Just over 4 years ago, it was simply no more than an idea. If I'm being completely honest, a lot of people thought I was slightly deluded. Here's this footballer, she should maybe just stick to playing a little bit of football. I was called a bit disruptive. My dad said, Kelly, I can't pay for you for the rest of your life. You need to get a proper job. And other people thought, you're far too young. You're going into a world or two worlds which are completely dominated by males. One's the football world and the other one's the business world. However, I'm quite proud to say I absolutely took no notice of anybody and saw the challenges presented as basically an opportunity to do something I felt extremely passionate about. As a result for it, I went for it. And now we don't just offer that 10-week educational programme. We offer a multitude of activities, from pre-employment programmes to supported employment programmes. We offer work placements for young people here and abroad at professional clubs. We offer consultancy advice for clubs from your local club all the way up to the Premier League. We've got our own BTEC in football industries, which they own the IP on across the whole of the world. And basically, if there's a social issue, we have a program that basically tackles it. So if it's somebody struggling with financial capability, we have a way to tackle that issue through sport. Our turnover has tripled. So in the first year, we had an income of 83,000. The second year, that tripled to over 300,000. We've just had our projections for the fourth year, and we're edging over close to the million mark. One thing I'm quite proud to say of, we have a very mere grant dependency of 15%, so you can do it. We work with football clubs in 12 local authority areas of Wales and in regions across the northwest of England. We have programmes operation in Spain, Germany, Holland, France, Poland, and we're currently expanding into cricket, swimming, golf, every sport really. We have 11 full-time members of staff, many of which have actually come through our programmes, have been in very disadvantaged backgrounds and have completely changed their lives. I have a very strong board of directors, and additionally, we are the first Wales Deloitte Social Innovation Pioneer. And we've recently received investment to go to India, the Far East, and we're about to launch the first ever football CEO game on a global platform. But most importantly, I think we've built a real credible track record, which indicates we deliver, but not only in terms of finances, but also when it comes to having a social impact. We know that 94% of all participants that engage in our programmes go on to have a job and sustain that job. We have a 95% retention rate where individuals come and they develop at least 5 soft skill outcomes and they gain recognised qualifications. All the clubs that we work with are at least 50% more profitable and have a greater connection to the local community. They actually care about what's going on. They also have an increased pool of volunteers. So gone are the days where dad coaches the football team, mum washes the kit. Nowadays, grandma used to be an accountant, so she looks after the finances, and my sister does the cheerleading at half time. So everybody gets really involved. Anybody who knows me well, I don't really talk too much about the awards we've won. In fact, I'm probably quite shy about it, which is, hope you young people don't ever get shy of that. We've won the UK Best Social Enterprise Startup of the Year. We've won the Wales Social Enterprise Leader of the Year. We've just recently been awarded the Big Society Award from the Prime Minister. But in recent times, I've become to realise that actually those awards represents the lives we have changed and bettered, and not only as a result of that are we far more inspired to be even better than what we are now and to keep pushing those boundaries over the next few years, but so are others. I want a Wales where every single one of us is very proud of their achievements, no matter how small they are, because what might be small for one person could be really big for another. I want basically for people not to be afraid to speak out and tell people what they want. I want a Wales where everybody gets chances and all our children flourish, and where there is a more enterprising culture running through our everyday lives. Because it's pretty cool to be a sports person, it's pretty cool to be a film star, it's pretty cool to be an entrepreneur. You can work your own schedules, you can work with the people you like, you can create your own opportunities, and you can grasp them and basically decide on your own destiny. You also make a little bit of money. And more importantly, the best thing about it is being able to have the ability to change people's perceptions about this and that and what should be. Hopefully, in this short 5 minutes or 10 minutes, I've offered an inspirational story to people, and I'd like to leave you with this. It's something I said 4 years ago and something I continually say today. If you don't dare to do something different, you'll never do something really special. Let's do something really special in Wales in the years to come and not live with any regrets about turning the challenges we currently face into opportunities we grasp. Thank you.
Kelly, thank you for giving your personal story. A bit disruptive, kids. Sometimes it's okay to be a bit disruptive. Are your teachers here? But because you do need that spark and following your passion and the message about you can do it. And your final bit about it's cool to be an entrepreneur. You know, we need more of those innovators, more of those entrepreneurs that you've done, how you've taken that forward in that way. And of course, the key message, we all know, it's women who are really going to change the world and make 2050 a better place. So Kelly, thank you very much. Final words from me, which are around next steps. We now need your support from today to carry this conversation forward through your organisations, through your communities, through your networks, to engage the people of Wales. We want to engage the people of Wales about the Wales we want. What are these long-term goals? You heard the minister give an indication of what he thinks as a starter for 10, the long-term goals should be. Are they the long-term goals that we want for Wales? What are the challenges and opportunities that will face us? Can we be a bit better informed about the challenges and opportunities that face us in achieving those aspirations? Critically, how will we know that we're heading in the right direction? What are the really important things that we want to measure for Wales? What's our scorecard as a nation? What do we really care about that we want to measure and be proud of? And finally, what are our responsibilities individually, corporately, communities, government, in terms of achieving these goals? Now, of course, the process will feed into the Future Generations Bill, and we've heard quite a bit about that today already. This is not a one-off consultation. It is not a one-off conversation. It's part of a process that will be embedded in legislation in the Future Generations Bill. I hope we can establish through this conversation a network of champions for the future, future champions who can carry that conversation forward, be a link to the commissioner and the new commissioner as established under the bill, advocates for future generations, a voice for future generations. If you go onto the Wales You Want website following today, you'll find a toolkit which will help you in starting that conversation as a future champion, guidance and information to help inform that conversation. And indeed, many of you will be joining the Minister, Jonathon, and possibly even Michael later in terms of a round table to discuss the role of those future champions. We're going to conduct the conversation, as you would imagine, through the social media as well, the interactive website, the Twitter feeds that we've touched on, and please leave those postcards behind in the more traditional way. We also have 180 organisations who've signed up to the Sustainable Development Charter. The Minister mentioned the Charter, including our hosts today, and a big thank you to our hosts, the Wales Millennium Centre, who will be committed to building into their work engaging young people on the creativity of the future Wales we want. We will also be working with and want to work with the companies of Wales, the businesses in Wales, those utterly brilliant innovators that Jonathon mentioned. A recognition that the future is here already, it's just a matter of knowing where to look for it. Jonathon mentioned that expansion of solar energy that he envisages. And just to highlight one very, very practical thing, if you want to be part of that, sign up to the EGNI Solar Challenge, the EGNI Share Offer, which is out today about expanding solar energy across communities in Wales. More details at the back. But we want to work with partner organisations at place level as well, because we know that it's people at the place level, quite often, where the passion lies. We heard about the passion of Portalbert. Making it real, focusing on the future for Tredegar, for instance, but connecting those conversations around Wales so that it's not just an individual conversation about the future, but it's part of that national conversation. And we'll supplement that local work with a series of national focus groups as part of this process. The Minister's indicated that we are not the only country taking this route. It's part of the United Nations process around establishing global sustainable development goals. And one of our key roles is to connect to that process. Thank you, UNICEF, for your support in that, and also to connect to other countries that are taking this route as well. The next key milestone will be June, when we will produce an interim report on the findings so far. That will coincide with the introduction of the Future Generations Bill into the National Assembly. But we'll continue the conversation following June to the production of the first draft, but the first report on behalf of future generations. And that will be embedded in the legislation, and government will have to respond to it, and it'll be part of how the public sector does its business going forward. So I, and particularly colleagues in Connell Cymru, and a big thank you to colleagues in Connell Cymru who've been behind putting this together today, along with four communications. We want to work with you to help shape those long-term goals, help shape that legislation, but above all, carry this conversation forward. We've been hugely appreciative of the input and the workshops and the poems that we've generated through the young people. And as the Minister said, the young people will be at the heart of this conversation. So before I pass back to Kerris, and a big thank you to Kerris, and actually it just does show the difference in generations. I've got pieces of paper here. Kerris has got a Kindle that she's reading off. But before I pass back to Kerris, could I just end with a big thank you to the young people who've been part of the process today, who've generated those poems that have given us such a great start to this conversation. So a big thank you to you.
Gai jyst rhoi diolch i fawr i pawb sydd wedi dod i cyfrannu heddiw sydd wedi rhoi ei ban ymlaen unai trwy'r cerdyn pôs neu trwy social media. Mae pawb yn gwerthfawrogi yr cymorth da ni wedi cael gan pawb sydd wedi dod i fyny i siarad heddiw. Ac dyna'r diwedd i heddiw, ond mae'r sgwrs am parhau ar ôl heddiw yn pellach ac o hyd i rhoi gwerthfawrogiad ac i trio cario ymlaen y sgwrs sydd yn digwydd trwy social media. So diolch yn gorffen heddiw, cario ymlaen i rhoi tweets i fyny ac ofyn i pawb arall wneud hefyd. So diolch yn fawr i pawb sydd wedi dod heddiw ac mwynhewch eich hunain.